That's a general rule, subject to multiple exceptions. And what are these exceptions that are scrutinized and merchandised by class rather than by cost? It is the $250 exception. What is $250 exception? It is those sections of the HTSUS. So when making evaluation for the whether the merchandise is eligible for informal entry based on the value, before you make a conclusion that it is for $2,000, you have to see where in HTSUS it belongs. And to make it more fun, customs examiners may actually double up. They gonna give you the facts, so you have to classify independently the merchandise. So that's a classification question. And then you have to figure out whether it qualifies for informal entry. So they can give you something like a woven blouse with that is made out of polyester, or gloves impregnated with plastics and rubber, which are woven, or the freezer suit, which is knit. Knit freezer suit, think about that. So, and it costs $500. So, because you're within the limit, so here, on the sideline, write down, if you are talking about the class or merchandise, and you are within this range, you have to ask yourself, what is the classification? And if it is belongs to classifications such as these sections, so if it's an article of plastic and it costs $500 under the old rules, it wasn't eligible for informal. I believe they circumcised that provision nowadays. But if you're going to see that this examination, you have to evaluate for that. Don't kill yourself over this, because this is something that's going away, especially this provision. Just keep in mind that they do exist. The rules have changed. And if you notice, again, based on the experience of the previous exam, when the HTS harmonized MPF and HMF harmonized, HMF harmonized, MPF is a manufacturing processing fee and harbor maintenance fee. Those are the fees that you pay on entry. They changed. Used to be 0.0024. Now it changed to 0.003 something. And same thing for HMF. They didn't test heavily on that because there was a change. So what it means is that because we're in a state of shift for this exam, be mindful of this. But I doubt that this will be subject to the heavy testing, this type of exception. But nonetheless, keep in mind, if this is a range, you must ask, is it plastic? Is it rubber? Is it a rawhide? Is it a leather article or the handbag? Is it a textile article like that knit sweater I was talking about? Is it a footwear or a headgear? Is it a furniture? Is it a sofa? Or a lamp? Those are just main points. Okay. If it is this, and it is not below 250, then it's not eligible for informal. If it's above 250. If it's below, it is eligible.
If it's below, it's eligible.
If it's below 250, it's eligible, yes.
It's over.
So, if it has this big list above 250, no informal. If it's below 250, then you can do informal for this. For everything else, it's 2,000. So 250 is just for this that I listed. All right? Does it make sense to everyone? So it's like value exception. First, you ask how much it costs. Second, where is it classified? in what chapter, HTSUS. And then you go back to the cost and you determine whether it is eligible based on the price. Okay? That's the concept of informal. Remember we talked about installments, different shipments at different times. Installments not exceeding $2,000 value arriving at different times can be entered as informal. So you have $10,000 shipment of merchandise which comes as installments under one purchase order. You can bring them if you consolidate them as one and you then decided to enter them, then subject to other provisions, you would have to do the formal entry because it's a $10,000 merchandise. But if you do 2,000, even though it's an installment, you can still do it. Okay, if it's a household effect, it's a personal item, it's a tool of trade or it's a book, and it costs $10,000, it costs $20,000, right? Value is irrelevant. You can still enter it as informal entry. But it must be one of those items. So this is a criteria where the price doesn't matter. Of course, with books, it cannot be for yourself. It must be for the public institution, such as library, or church, or the science center. Here is an interesting one. We talked about the cornea procedure. Cornea can be served as an entry document. So you're on a trade show bandwagon, right? You go from United States to Germany. What's the code for Germany? Come on. DE, right? Then it goes to Australia, AU. Then it goes to United Kingdom. Is it UK or is it GB? GB, B is in boy, right? Okay. And then it comes back to the United States after being presented. You took it abroad and returned it under cornea procedure. Cornea allows you to enter. So cornea is a document which you can enter under uniform procedures in Germany, in Australia, in Great Britain, in England. Upon the entry to the United States, it appears, the way these rules are written, is that you return the merchandise from the trade show. So really, you give up your cornea once you enter. So once you give it up, you need to enter it. And if you recall, cornea is defined as an entry document which can be used instead of 7501. It's a separate mechanism, right? And it also can be used as a bond. So you don't need to file a bond, no 301, no 7501 if you have cornea. However, when you return, it appears as if when you return, so you're not bringing it into the country under carne, but you rather return it from the trade show. And when you return after taking it abroad, then irrespective of value, you can qualify it for informal entry. So let's say you have a computer, or let's say I bring back the 10 projectors, which are valued $5,000 altogether. $5,000 under the carne procedures qualifies for informal. Make sense? Here's a good one, which probably you all know. So how many of you came into the country which you had to fill out the declaration and you always wonder, how much do I declare so I don't have to pay any duties or taxes or fees? And the answer is found here. So shipment of merchandise qualifying for administrative exemptions. And those administrative exemptions include merchandise imported by one person on one day having a fair retail value not over 200. So you bring in $200 worth.
I have to pay duty.
Under 200 or less?
No.
Mm-mm. Yes, you're right. So highlight administrative exemptions. Highlight by one person on one day having a fair retail value over 200. That is subject to informal. Then take a note on the bona fide gifts. Now the gifts itself, they're usually shipped, right? So when you ship a gift, the very first question that you ask is where is this coming from? Because the gift shipment is subject to informal entry, and this is usually you deal with the postal service, right? Because you utilize USPS, but not necessarily. If it comes from Virgin Islands, Guam, or American Samoa, then it's $200. If it comes from any other places not listed, then it can be $100. For the rest, is outside of administrative exemption, and you probably have to pay a duty on that. Take a note, Virgin Islands, Guam, American Samoa, the U.S. territory. So, on a side note, write down that this is outside of customs territory of the United States, because those are specifically type of locations which customs has tested as asking, is it within the U.S. territory or not? So, well, we went through this list of entries which can qualify for informal entry. Just like with many other procedures, this is not a default rule. This is more like a privilege which can be taken away, which means that informal entry can be disqualified from internal, from informal entry. And because we are dealing with the government, and because government must give you some kind of process before taking that privilege away from you, you need to be aware that those points may disqualify otherwise qualified entry. So you have an entry based on value which costs $800. and it is within it is not one of those exceptions, right? It is not plastic, lamps, tables, etc. Sorry? So it is not within exceptions. So for imported material for enforcement purposes, revenue protection and efficient conduct of customs business. So revenue protection. That may be the problem, for example, with merchandise subject to anti-dumping duties. Remember, we talked in the beginning of class, I mentioned the evasion of duties, which caused the Customs and Border Protection to adopt the cash-only bond requirements. Well, remember, the bond shall not be required for the informal entry. But it is the cash-only bond which ensures that the merchandise, that the revenue of customs is adequately protected for the merchandise subject to anti-dumping duties. This means that to function more efficiently, to protect the revenue, if the merchandise is subject to anti-dumping duties, it may still be disqualified from the informal entry. You still, even though it was otherwise qualifiable, because of these other items that customs feels like it must be entered formally, formal entry can be required. Now here is the important point that I want to drive home. Usually I don't talk much about the form. I don't talk much about the form because form is a form, right? You just follow the rules like applying for ABI to become ABI certified. You just file a form, you have your due process, you must include certain information, etc., etc. Sometimes I pay a lot of attention to the form. We saw that in the context of CBP Form 7501, to a limited extent, CBP Form 3461. Now there comes another form, which is CBP Form 368. Go to page 19 for me, please. Take a look how simple that informal entry is. It just has much fewer line items that you need to fill out. So, how do you declare informal entry? We're back to page 15. You can use 7501. We know that. We just look up the informal entry type and fill it in. But you can also use those. By hand, write it out. It must be sequentially numbered. But look at this. You can use 368 alternative, 7501, but you sometimes also do not have to use that. You can just don't use any customs form, right? You can just use commercial invoice. So you can do away with any forms for informal. And why is this important? Because for administrative purposes, if you don't have to fill out any forms, how much time it saves you? A lot, right? So if you're gonna do the invoice one, you have to jump through additional hoops. So you do away with one thing, you actually become subject to requirements of another thing. So first of all, you must seek permission before you do that. You ask permission from U.S. Customs. It says port director, but also any customs officer which is authorized to act on behalf of port director. And you have the following declaration on the invoice. And of course, there are multiple exceptions. baggage declaration. Anyone remembers the baggage declaration when you come in, you have that little form that looks bluish type form, which you fill out? That's that is normally for the baggage declaration. So it is in a way exception to the form like 368 or the invoice, right? So how can you otherwise? You can come to customs and you can say, well, customs, look at this rule, right? I took my license customs examination and I know for a fact that 143.23 says I can just present it by the invoice. So here is my invoice, which is in Chinese, for the cattle which I bring, which I purchased in China or for whatever merchandise. So, but again, look, this is a general rule, and a general rule is subject to exceptions. So customs will say, yes, it is in fact true, but in the case of baggage declaration requirement, you must fill out that form. So when you fly into the country and you are being handed that form, and you think you don't have to do that just because, think again, because this is an exception to the rule, and they give it to you, and it is required. So no getting away for you dealing with a baggage declaration if you fly in with the stuff. Next, products returned for which clearance is required. This is usually deals with the stuff that have been sent, that have been within the customs custody. And I believe, remember the general note 3, where customs, they haven't left the customs custody or the carrier, and they've been returned within 45 days, something like that. So pretty much this is what it says. If it's returned, for which product of the United States being returned, made in the United States, comes back to the United States. And then again, personal effects and tools of trade. For those, this form is required. Remember, we're talking about the form, we talked about substantive portions, right? So here, remember when we talk about personal effects, household effects, here we established that personal effects, irrespective of value, can be entered informally. Anyone remembers that? This is substantive, this is the background. Next, after we establish, okay, yes, it can be entered, what form do we use? So for personal effects, we use this form, 3299. So we are talking about the pro forma. You can also use for the value exceptions, the CBP form 7523. But here is a major one, and the stuff which